Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wassalatu wassalam ala Sayyidina wa Nabiyyina wa Mawlana Muhammadin Abduhu wa Rasuluh. Sallallahu tabarak wa ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa baraka wa sallama tasliman kathiran kathira amma ba'd. Faqad qala Allahu ta'ala fi kitabihi al-aziz. بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وعسى أن تكرهوا شيء وهو خير لكم وعسى أن تحبوا شيء وهو شر لكم والله يعلم وأنتم لا تعلمون وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إن أعظم الجزاء مع أعظم البلاء وإن الله إذا أحب قوما ابتلاهم فَمَنْ رَضِيَ فَلَهُ الرِّضَى وَمَنْ سَخِطَ فَلَهُ السُّخْطُ أَوْ كَمَا قَالَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَاتُ وَالسَّلَامُ. Brothers and sisters, the calamities, the trials, the difficulties that we face in life, they will be unbearable for you to handle. They will be too heavy for you to carry on your shoulders. Unless and until you change the perspective through which you see them. The calamities and the difficulties that we face in life, they will be utterly unbearable for us to handle. They will be too heavy for our shoulders until and unless we change the perspective through which we view them. What the Qur'an and what the sunnah of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam is teaching us is that it is not the calamity that matters, but rather how you see the calamity and how you react to the calamity. I was preparing this khutbah over the last few days, and when I was in the restroom on my way out, I heard two gentlemen speaking. They're present with us right now, and they were speaking about some of the hardship that they were going through. Some of the hardship and difficulty. And one of the brothers said to the other brother, "Imtihan hai bas." He said, "Imtihan." Yani fil Arabi, imtihan, it's a test. He said, "Imtihan." And the other said, "Exactly." So I said to myself, I said, you know, I might have to switch up my khutbah. Because, you know, these brothers already got the idea. They already understand that the difficulties we go through, that pain that the brother was speaking about that he's feeling in his knee, he already understood that if I don't understand this from the correct perspective, I won't be able to psychologically deal and cope with the difficulties that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given me. So mashallah, this brother's parents and his family have raised him to understand that whatever difficulty we struggle through, whatever hardship we go through, it's all about how you look at that hardship and how you respond to that. And there is no better place to begin than with the blessed life of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who lost 6 of his 7 children in his own life. Who lost 6 of his 7 children in his own life. Who was exiled from his own beloved country and city. Who went through all types of curse words and physical abuse, emotional abuse, that would be unbearable for anyone else. But when we look at the reaction of our beloved Habib Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when we look at Habibullah, the beloved of Allah, when we look at how he responded to those tribulations, we see nothing other than the prophetic and beautiful divine response in a hadith in Bukhari, which beautifully depicts what I'm speaking about today, about how you see the difficulties you go through, what lens you use to look at them. The Rasul Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he says, قال رسول صلى الله عليه وسلم ألا تعجبون كيف يصرف الله عني شتم قريش وَلَعْنَهُمْ يَشْتِمُونَ مُذَمْذَمْ وَيَلْعَنُونَ مُذَمْذَمْ وَأَنَا مُحَمَّدْ صلى الله عليه وسلم. Look at his psychological coping and dealing with the curse words of his people, the verbal abuse. Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu in this hadith of Bukhari says that the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he one day said to the believers, to the Muslims, he said, have you guys noticed ala ta'jabun? Isn't it amazing? Kayfa sarrafa Allah anni shatama Quraysh? Isn't it amazing how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has protected me and pushed away from me the curse words of Quraysh? See, the Quraysh, they didn't like the name Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. They didn't like the name Muhammad because when you say that name, you're automatically praising the one that has the name. So they wouldn't call him Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And they would change it to the X. They would change it to the opposite. The opposite of the most praiseworthy is the most blameworthy. So they would call him Mudhamdham. Mudhamdham. Anytime they want to talk about him, they say, Mudhamdham yaf'alu kadha. Mudhamdham said this. Mudhamdham said that. So Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, most of us would take that to heart. Hey, call me by my name. You know who I am? Call me by my name. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, look at the perspective through which the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he looked at this. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, look how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has turned away from me the swear words and the curses of the Quraysh. They're making fun of some cat, some brother, some dude named Mudhamdham. My name is Muhammad. Joke's on them. But look at how he's dealing. Look at the optimism. That is why there's a saying in English that the optimist, the pessimist, sees a hardship in every situation. But the optimist sees the opportunity in every situation. And that is what the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is teaching us. He's teaching us that we have to change our perspective. Brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us right in the beginning of the Quran, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was creating Adam, the angels asked, أَتَجْعَلُ فِيهَا مَن يُفْسِدُ فِيهَا وَيَسْفِكُ الدِّمَاء. They placed this question right in the beginning of the Quran. They said, Ya Allah, are you going to create this creation that will sow corruption in the land and cause hardship and bloodshed and all types of evil will come from these people? Are you going to create that? وَنَحْنُ نُسَبِّهُ بِحَمْدِكَ وَنُقَدِّسُ لَكَ. Here we are, we just glorify you, Ya Allah. Are you going to create such creation with hardships and difficulties and all these evil things? The response from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is training us, which is teaching us, the response from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was, إِنِّي أَعْلَمُ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. You know, Jalal ad-Din al-Rumi, a great scholar from our history who we barely ever quote, Jalal ad-Din Rumi, he tells a very interesting story. He tells a story about a chickpea. You know, a chickpea, chana, whatever you call it, chickpea, right? He tells a story about a chickpea who, when the housewife is at home making food, she throws the chickpea into the pot of boiling water. And the chickpea, it's just a story, guys, just a story for a lesson. The chickpea keeps coming back to the top. And the chickpea keeps coming back to the top. And Jalal ad-Din Rumi says, it's like the chickpea is saying, why are you boiling me? Why are you boiling me? This water is hot. What are you doing to me? So the one cooking the food takes the spoon and pushes the chickpea down, but the chickpea comes back up again. Why are you doing this to me? Why are you doing this to me? Keeps coming up. Until finally the one cooking, she says, you don't realize what I'm making out of you. You don't realize how tasty you'll be, how soft you'll be. You don't realize what this water is doing to you. Go back down again until you're ready. A better example, that's Jalal ad-Din Rumi's example, but a better example is if you've ever seen a sword maker. When he takes that raw iron and he places it in that fire for so long. and the iron becomes very, very hot. But when it becomes hot, it becomes malleable as well. So when the iron comes out of that fire, what does the sword maker begin to do with it? You've seen it in the movies, I'm sure. I don't know if you guys don't make swords at home. I know no one in Tulsa has a sword making business, but I'm sure you've seen it somewhere. They take out the heavy mallet and they begin to hit that sword while it's still malleable. Then after that, what do they do after that? They place it in cold water. Then take it out again and put it in a hot fire so it becomes malleable again. Then they take it out and they hit it again. This piece of iron is saying, what are you doing to me? What are you doing to me? Hot, cold, hot, cold. What's the purpose of all this? What's the hikmah behind all this? But the blacksmith just keeps on pounding away. Quiet, you don't know what I'm making out of you. You don't know what you're becoming through these hardships. And that's why the first thing we need to understand is that the primary reason we can't handle and deal with the hardships that we go through is because we have a problem of egocentrism. We have a problem of egocentrism, which is we only look at the difficulty from our own perspective. We only look at the difficulty from our limited perspective. That I can't understand why I'm losing my job. I can't understand why these difficulties are happening in our family. From my limited perspective, they make no sense. This is exactly what the Malaika said. They said, "Atajalu biha mayus." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to them, change your perspective. You're looking at it from a limited perspective. You need to look at it from a broader perspective. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching us that. That these difficulties have a reason for them. There's a beautiful wisdom behind all of them. Al-Iz Abdus Salam. I'm getting to my main point here. Al-Iz Abdus Salam. He wrote a book called Fawaidul Mihn Wal Fitan Wal Masa'ib. He wrote a book, and the name of this book is Fawaid, the benefits of mihn, trials, fitan, tribulations, wal masa'ib, and hardships. And in this book, Al-Iz Abdus Salam, he enumerates numerous benefits of why we go through calamities. And I wanted to share with you today some of the gems from this work, because when you understand some of the hikmah, the difficulty becomes a bit lighter to take. The very first thing he reminds us is that the word fitna comes from a root word in Arabic which means to heat something up with fire. فَتَنْتَ الْعُودَ عَلَى النَّارِ. I took the wood, I took the iron, I placed it on fire, and I heated it up. And what he said is you don't realize that heating things up is often the way to purify them. Heating things up is often the way, and as I gave you the example of the chickpea and the sword, we realize why the word fitna, to heat things up, is deeply connected to the trials and tribulations that we go through. He also reminds us something else. He says the word musiba. إِذَا أَصَابَكُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ قَالُوا إِنَّ لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّ إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. The Arabic word for a calamity is a musiba. But the beautiful thing about the Arabic language is it gives you a window into deeper meanings of reality. The word musiba means a calamity. But when you say asabta, asabt, it means you hit the mark. If you were to shoot an air bow and arrow and you hit the bullseye, you would say asabta, asabt, you hit the mark. What this teaches us is that these hardships are not coincidental. That flat tire you got on the way, there was no way you could have missed that nail. There was no way it hit the mark. It hit right where it was supposed to be. This is profound. This is so deep. The reason it's so deep, because it reminds me that this is not coincidental. This is not a mere chance, but rather this is what Allah has chosen for me, and it hit the mark right where it was supposed to be. SubhanAllah. Right there, that changes everything. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, regarding this concept of it hitting the mark, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what does this idea, when you understand that the calamity, the flat tire, the family trouble, when you understand that those things are right where they're supposed to be and Allah didn't make a mistake by making you struggle, when you understand that, what does that produce inside of you? Well, there's a hadith of the Rasul. There's a hadith in which the Rasul, he says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ إِذَا أَحَبَّ قَوْمًا إِبْتَلَاهُمْ. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves someone or loves a group of people, He tries them, He tests them. He tries and He tests them. Look back at the example of that iron that was getting ibtila, that the sword maker was making into a beautiful Excalibur sword. That sword maker chose that piece of iron that you're going to be different from everyone else. But he says, فَمَنْ رَضِيَ. Now here's the key. Here's the key. When you realize that the musibah, asabta, when the musibah has hit its mark, there's two reactions. Rasul, he says, فَمَنْ رَضِيَ فَلَهُ الرِّضَى وَمَنْ سَخِتَ فَلَهُ السُّخْتَ. Rasul, he says, you know the reaction? There'll be two types of people when hardships come. There'll be two reactions you can have. Everyone in this masjid, there are two reactions you can have to a musibah. مَنْ رَضِيَ, whoever is pleased, فَلَهُ الرِّضَى. The musibah comes, the hardship comes, you go, Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah ala kulli hal. You become pleased with it. Alhamdulillah. It's like the coach. You know when you play on a sports team and the coach starts to give you extra attention? He makes you come to practice more. He makes you run more laps. And everybody else is jealous. Everybody else on the team is jealous. Because they know when the coach puts you through more work, it's because he loves you more. More attention. You have more potential. I'm going to push you to a higher level. So Rasul said there's two reactions. The first reaction with that pain in your knee, the first reaction you can have with that pain in your back, the reaction you can have with that lost job or a bad grade, فَمَنْ رَضِيَ فَلَهُ الرِّضَى. First reaction, you can become complacent and pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's decree, and He says, فَلَهُ الرِّضَى. When you become happy and pleased, guess what happens? Allah becomes happy and pleased with you. Sahaba radiallahu anhu wa radu anhu. Ridha. But there's another reaction. There's another reaction when you get a flat tire. There's another reaction when the car won't start. There's another reaction when you lose the job. وَمَنْ سَخِتَ. There are some people, سَخِتَ. They become angry. They become upset. They become discontented. مَنْ سَخِتَ. And you know what the Rasul ﷺ says is the result of your displeasure, your discontentment, your anger? You know the result of that? فَلَهُ السُّخْتِ. Die in your anger. You boil in your anger, that's it. You get out the car, flat tire, what do? You kick the tire, then you hurt your foot. The tire didn't do anything. They didn't solve anything. SubhanAllah, I was teaching this to some of our students, and one of my students said something that was really profound. Our little children, sometimes they bump their knee, they hit their head on a table, they hurt themselves. I'm talking toddlers here. They hurt themselves. Many of us, we've probably done this before. They bump into a table, and what do? You go, bad table, don't do that again. If you're a parent, you may know what I'm talking about. You hit the table. So one of my students, they're a major in psychology and child development, they said, this teaches the wrong message to the child. This teaches the complete opposite message to the child. No, don't say that. Don't hit the table and say, bad table. Bad table, you hurt me. Because it's already preparing them for this mentality. مَنْ سَخِتَ فَلَهُ السُّخْتِ. Subhan, very profound. Rasul ﷺ in this hadith is teaching us, brothers and sisters. He says you can have two reactions to these calamities. You can understand that they hit the mark, they're there for a reason. Now I want to talk about Ibn Abdul Salam. Al-Iz Abdul Salam gives roughly 7-8 fawa'id. Fawa'id, or benefits of hardships. I want you to remember these benefits. Because as you're struggling and you look back at these benefits, you'll say Alhamdulillah. You'll say Alhamdulillah, because you remember what you're getting out of it. Number one, he says, it reminds the soul that this world doesn't remain forever. كُلُّ نَفْسٍ دَائِكَةُ الْمَوْتِ. You're going through a hardship, It reminds you, you know what? This world is finite. This ain't gonna last, bro. This is short. It'll be over soon. So he says one of the first benefits is that it reminds you of the shortness of life. It reminds you of the temporary nature of the hardship that you're going through. Number one. Number two, he says, through the hardship, you gain the recognition of the blessing of afia and peace in good situations. What does that mean? When you're sick, you remember how nice it was to be healthy. Only when you're sick do you really value health. Only when you lose a blessing, only when the well runs dry do we value the water that was in the well. So Ibn Abdus Salam, he says, the second benefit is when you go through that hardship, it reminds you of the blessing of afia, peace that you had before. And then you do shukr for the afia you had. When you do shukr, you get it back. Number three, which I mentioned already, he says that this gains the ridha of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It gains the happiness of Allah. You realize that as I'm being patient through this, as I'm content, man radiya, falahu ridha, the one who is content, Allah's happiness comes to him. Like the sahaba radiyallahu an wa radu an. Number four, he says, and this is beautiful, he says, it breaks the arrogance in your heart. The Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, مَنْ كَانَ فِي قَلْبِ مِثْقَالَ حَبَّةٍ مِنْ كِبْرٍ لَمْ يَدْخُلُ الْجَنَّةِ أَوْ كَمَا قَالَ. Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he says, the one who has an atom's weight of arrogance will not enter into the doors of paradise. Paradise is for the humble people. So Ibn Abdus Salam, he says, when you get that cold, when you get sickness, when your bones are aching, it reminds you, where's all that arrogance you had when you were 20 years old? It breaks you down. So Ibn Iz Abdus Salam says that these hardships that come, they break the arrogance inside of you. And Ibn Qayyim al-Jawzi, he says that the only dawa, the only cure for arrogance is these hardships that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala often afflict us with. Very profound. Number five, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, مَا يُصِيبُ الْمُؤْمِنْ مِنْ وَصَبٍ وَلَا نَصَبٍ وَلَا هَمٍ وَلَا حَزَنٍ. Rasul Sallallahu, he says, no physical pain, no emotional, mental pain, any type of struggle you go through, حَتَّ الشَّوْكُ يُشَافُهَا. Rasul Sallallahu, he said, even a thorn that pricks your finger, إِلَّا كَفَرَ اللَّهُ, it's purification. As we say, someone's sick, we go, لَا بَأْسَ تُهُورِ إِشَاءَ اللَّهُ. We go, don't worry, Allah's purifying you. Like that piece of gold that's placed in fire and the impurities are separated from the gold and being purified through that difficulty. But the outcome is better than what it was before and went through that. So Rasul Sallallahu, he reminds us. The next one, brothers and sisters, because time, I'll say it in the next khutbah, inshallah. أَقُولُ قَالِ هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَلِسَائِرِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوا إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. Bismillah wa salatu wa salam ala Rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala. Al-Iz bin Abdus Salam, he says that another benefit of the calamities and the struggles that we go through is that it's training for your soul. It's training for your soul and training for your qalb, your heart. Just as the football coach or basketball coach knows that the difficulties you go through are training for you. Similarly, the difficulties that we go through in this life are training for us to take us to a higher level. Hilm, forbearance. Sabr, patience. Courage. Shuja'ah, bravery. All of these are qualities that your soul strives to have. All of these are soul qualities that your soul should have inside of them. Alhim, forbearance, patience, shukr, gratitude. All of these are things that we want to beautify our heart with. But what you have to understand is this. There are first order goods and second order good. First order good, nice food, comfort, relax. These are first order good and they're second order goods. Second order goods are like bravery, patience, forbearance, higher order goods, higher goods. The key is this, you'll never ever reach the higher until you give up the lower. It's always about sacrificing the lower to attain the higher one. So he says that the benefit that we're gaining from these difficulties is that it's elevating our ruh, it's elevating our soul, it's making us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I think I'm going to end with one more, inshallah ta'ala. Perhaps this may be the one that you needed to hear. One of the benefits of the difficulties we go through is that it forces us to go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The hardships you go through, they force you, they humble you, they break you down, and they force you to go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They force you to realize who you are. They force you to realize that you are an abd of Allah. As Allah says, إِذَا أَصَابَتْكُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ. When the musibah hits, what do they say? Inna lillah, I belong to Allah. I'm an abd, I'm a slave. Wa inna ilayhi, you realize your position. You go back to Allah. Wa inna ilayhi raji'un. And back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala we go. Brothers and sisters, this life is by design built with difficulties and hardships. And those hardships are not to be mitigated. They're not to be gone completely. The best of people, the anbiya, the prophets, went through hardship. But what is our responsibility is to change the lens through which we see those hardships. To see that every hardship is an opportunity for progress. Every hardship is an opportunity to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept all of us. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to alleviate our suffering and hardships. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make it easy for us. Those who are suffering, Allah, I ask Allah to make it easy for them. Ya Rabbil Alameen. Ibadullah rahimakumullah. Inna Allah ya'muru bil adli wal ihsan. Wa ita'i dil qurba wa yanha anil fahsha'i wal munkari wal baghi. Ya'idhukum la'allakum tadhakkaroon. Fadhkuru Allah ta'ala yadhkurkum. Wada'uhu yastajib lakum. Wa ladhikru Allahi akbar. والله يعلم ما تصنعون أقيم الصلاة